Tonight, St. Lucians told to stay hydrated amid concerns that high temperatures could lead to heat-related illnesses. Guy Joseph continues to downplay calls for his resignation or dismissal over what the opposition says is his gross misbehavior. The Ministry of Agriculture blames climate change and bad agricultural practices for declining bee populations, and St. Lucia and Cuba extend cooperation in the health sector. Good evening. Welcome to the Monday edition of DBS News World with me, Kendall Burton. The St. Lucia Met Service is urging St. Lucians to stay hydrated as the island experiences high temperatures. The department is concerned about the potential impact on human health as high temperatures could lead to increased hospital admissions due to heat-related illnesses. Sheffield Gillard begins our news coverage with that story.
According to Mr. Venantius Descott, the Met Service earlier this year observed changes in the climate. Daytime temperatures were slightly below normal. However, nighttime temperatures appeared to be higher.
So you'll find that people will feel very hot, hotter at night. And also, from the beginning of the year, we noticed that our rainfall has been below average. You know, or below what we typically call our climatological mean. And for the period May to July, we expect similar conditions to continue. We expect that trend to continue.
Earlier this year, the Caribbean Climate Outlook Forum, based in Barbados, warned Caribbean countries that rainfall in some islands would be significantly less, which would result in extensive drought and warmer temperatures than usual. Mr. Descott says this should be of major concern to the public because of the health risk associated with prolonged exposure to extreme temperatures.
When it's very hot and dry, people tend to suffer from heat stress. Not only people, but also plants and animals as well. So my advice would be to drink plenty of water to avoid dehydration. When you have such conditions, you find that water levels in streams or rivers are kind of low. You find that production of water is being limited. So I would advise people to conserve water as much as possible. Do not waste water. And continue to monitor the situation.
Other risks include fatigue, exhaustion, asthma attacks, and in extreme cases, heat stroke. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Economic Development Minister Guy Joseph continues to question the authenticity of a letter being circulated on social media, which allegedly bears his signature and purportedly awards $162 million worth of contracts to a private entity without parliamentary approval. The opposition has called for the minister to be relieved of his duties if it can be proven that he did indeed sign the document. Don Nicholas has more.
The St. Lucia Labour Party has insisted that Economic Development Minister Guy Joseph be relieved of his duties if it can be proven that he signed the letter being circulated on social media and which purportedly awards $162 million worth of contracts to a private entity without parliamentary approval. Opposition leader Philip J. Pierre is adamant that Prime Minister Alan Chasney should take action.
Any serious Prime Minister would have called his minister to task and tell him, if any of my ministers, and they would never do that, wrote a letter, and the minister on public television in a very popular talk show goes and tries to say the important thing is how can a private letter be out and never says, I am not the one who signed this letter. A letter purporting to give $162 million worth of contracts to an individual or to an individual firm.
Mr. Joseph has continued to question the authenticity of the letter, stating that all letters signed by him are in his ministry. Additionally, the minister says that the online document does not represent a contract. The minister fired back at the opposition leader, accusing him of remaining mute on the Grindberg matter and other issues. Mr. Joseph says calls for his resignation are absurd.
I say the opposition leader is just a fool. That's what he is. You know, for let me say here, and for anybody to even say that a minister should resign over whether a letter was written, I mean, it is absurd.
The minister spoke at Monday's pre-cabinet press briefing. For the DBS News World, I'm Don Nicholas.
The Republic of China, Taiwan presented the government of St. Lucia with $12.5 million for the next two phases of the constituency's development program today. The presentation took place at the office of the Prime Minister on Monday morning. Don Nicholas was there.
Locally, the Ministry of Agriculture has partnered with the Japanese through the Japan Caribbean Climate Change Project to come up with responses to the effects of climate change, including the declining of bee populations. The Japan Caribbean Climate Change Partnership brings together policymakers, experts, and representatives of communities to encourage policy innovation for climate technology incubation and diffusion.
We looked at artificial instrumentation of bees to collect the semen out of the drones and inseminate the females. And we've also been looking at queen rearing. If we increase the stock of queens on the island, then we can definitely increase the stock of bees on the island. Along with that, we have another project where we look at livelihoods, where we've tried to train young apiculturists to provide them with the skills so that they can get into that industry. The industry is an untapped market because we have not been able to satisfy the local demand. And also it is one of the products that has tremendous export potential for the island.
Richard Mathias, the president of the Ianola Apiculture Collective, says a number of factors have contributed to the drop in bee numbers, but the biggest culprit is climate change.
The unpredictable weather patterns that we're facing, like right now it's very, very, very dry and hot, but earlier in the year it was very, very rainy, lots of wind, when the early flowers for the season were flowering. So you've got this unpredictable cycle of weather patterns that are affecting the flowering of the bee, of the flowering of the plants, which is the bees are dependent on. And also when the flowers are in bloom, you've got the weather patterns are affecting the flowers, as in throwing them down to the ground, or the wind is blowing them down, or they don't have enough nectar to really provide for the bees as such. So this, along with some pests and diseases as well, that's slightly a problem to the bees, and you know, general loss of forage as well. As urbanization and urban sprawl spreads, traditional areas where beekeeping has been practiced, we are losing some of those areas and some of the good natural forage that the bees have depended upon over the years.
Mr. Constantine says the ministry is now looking at increasing the number of people involved in apiculture, including the youth. There are plans to form an incubator and provide training for these young people. But even with all these plans, the low numbers of flowering plants left on the island remains a challenge.
We have been losing a lot of the old growth plants and the dry forest. And this is one of the places where the bees do most of their foraging. So there are conversations to increase the amount of fruit trees and also to give some protection to the old growth dry forests where the bees do most of the foraging. We expect at the end of the two projects to have an increase in the stock of bees, the increase in the production of honey, an increase in the amount of people entering the industry, because the industry is an untapped market. It is one of the areas in agriculture that we can do a lot more than we're presently doing.
Mr. Constantine says the St. Lucia beekeepers and the Ministry of Agriculture continue their efforts to discourage the indiscriminate use of pesticides. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Buske.
Time now to join Alex Buske for today's edition of Street Vibes.
The Republic of China, Taiwan handed over a check for the second phase of the 2018 Constituency Development Program, totaling $2,284,970, and a check for the first phase of the 2019 program in the amount of $10,215,160. The program, which started in 2007, has employed over 2,500 persons and seen over 2,400 projects implemented. Flood mitigation, soil stabilization, and the construction of footpaths and proper drainage are among the projects completed under the initiative.
So far, the program plays a crucial role for the development of not only capacity, but also the economic growth of St. Lucia. As we know, global warming and climate change affect all mankind and the sustainability of the world. Caribbean countries are particularly prone to enormous economic losses from hurricanes in recent years. So it is imperative to ensure the safety of the St. Lucia people.
Projects also included the construction of a park at Mont Fortune, which will be officially opened on the first Sunday in June. Wi-Fi services will be available at the new facility.
I can tell you one of the projects that was financed, the financing started back in 2010-11, that is of the park at the Mont. The opening is scheduled for the first Sunday in June. I think that's somewhere around the second, so I'm informing the media from early that we are going to have the formal opening of this park, because it is another project that is going to bring special benefits to the community.
Acting Prime Minister Leonard Matute was very grateful for the donation.
We can see the difference that it makes at the constituency level. And so I want to express also as a parliamentary representative myself, my sincere gratitude and appreciation.
According to Mr. Matute, Taiwan, through donations, has contributed significantly to St. Lucia's national development, especially in the areas of agriculture and information and communications technology, or ICT. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
The local Ministry of Agriculture is using today's observance of World Bee Day to create awareness of the increasing need to preserve bees and other pollinators. The 2019 theme is Save the Bees. It is designed to draw public attention to rapidly declining bee populations the world over. The main reasons for this bee decline: industrial agriculture, parasites, pathogens, and climate change. Alex Busquet tells us more.
Hi, I'm Alex Busquet, and you're watching Street Vibes. Today, the people speak to an open mic.
There are some solutions work for themselves, right? You step out, you go out hustling like me. You go to the hospital has free clinics. There's the nurses' home, there's the cancer clinic, there's the eye clinic. People barely get anything to eat. 6 o'clock, 5 o'clock, people are lined up there already. They cannot move. I'm going to the hospital to sell. You mean to tell me that is such of a hazard or such of a problem that administration and even the security officers right now ban anybody from coming and sell at the hospital? What harm is somebody doing trying to make a daily bread to survive? If I'm not working, I'm not doing anything, and I start robbing places, then I'm the worst person out. Come on, the government need to do something. You're cutting off people's bread, man.
There is a saying that cleanliness is next to godliness, and this is very true. I think we as St. Lucians should take more pride in our country. Castries City, it's too dirty. Every morning, you get lots of garbage all around the city of Castries. The gutters need to be unclogged. It's not about just taking out the rubbish, but taking out the water and pouring something in the gutter, give it a nice scent, because we're promoting tourism and we want to keep it as a number one country.
I have a fiscal problem, man problem. I have a lot of people who about minister, but I don't have a lot. It just sounds like a shy bike, a shy cotter, pop, total highway, not so good as a bike. I fed. I keep on montaing la. When we got to come on bien ça. Na brain, I manger, aussi qu'on bien, l'autre monde ou, monsieur ça aussi. So, my opinion, pièce problème. So, so, you know, you have a big problem, sir. I got deep about you against me.
God is real. St. Lucian, Jesus Christ loved everybody. That's why he died on the cross of Calvary. And he's coming back soon. He laid down his life. They didn't take his life, but he laid down his life for the world. And right now, we're living perilous time on us. So my friend, prepare to meet the Savior, because he loves all of us.
There's a whole lot of complaints in this country. Complaints. But the problem lies within us. There is a God. We claim to be Christians. And everything God requires us to do, we don't do. And so, we must not forget what the Bible says, the word of God. And the Bible is true. And nobody cannot tell me the Bible not true, because the Bible has worked for me.
Well, there you have it. You've just been watching Street Vibes with me, Alex Buske, down here at the Aquarius Crossing, the intersection of Coral and St. Louis Streets. With that, we'll take you back to our studio.
You're watching St. Lucia's Television and News Leader, and listening to us on Rhythm FM 95.5 and also the Wave 94.5 and 93.7 FM. We're also online on the big screen at the Aquarius Crossing in downtown Castries. When we come back, the police and the GNT strike a deal, and St. Lucia and Cuba extend cooperation in the health sector. In other news, mathematics teachers and officials from the Department of Education are currently reviewing the local mathematics curriculum with a view to reversing declining math scores. Sheffield Gaylord tells us more.
Earlier this year, Police Welfare Association President Travis Chico said while the two sides were able to reach agreement on a variety of issues, that of salaries remained unresolved. GNT Chairman Vern Gill on Friday said that the negotiations covered two periods and as such, the GNT needed to make adjustments which took time. According to the new agreement, government will pay a lump sum of $1,500 to PWA members for the period 2016 to 2019. There will be a 1% salary increase for the period 2018 to 2019 and for the period 2019 to 2022. 1% increase will be given in the first year 2019 to 2020, 1% in the second year 2020 to 2021, and 2% in the last year 2021 to 2022. PWA President Travis Chico says the signing was a victory for his members.
We've agreed on a number of positions, as I've said, that the real purpose of the negotiation was really to add value to the members of the Royal St. Lucia Police Force. I believe that coming out of the negotiations, having presented the position to our members, having presented the position to our members, they are a bit satisfied, and having returned to the general membership for voting, members agreed unanimously to accept the proposal as is by the government negotiating team. I am very happy that at least members are able to see a shift in the salaries coming in the few days, that they would enjoy the benefits given to them, and also to secure a landmark deal where the police at this point, in terms of part of its national crime strategy, that the insurances would now be a big part of the police to really boost their morale and confidence.
GNT Chairman Vern Gill expressed satisfaction with the process, which he describes as cordial.
I would like to commend association for applying the necessary skills and thought to the whole process. We are pleased that the negotiations have ended and have, as it is now, covered the period from 1st of April 2016 to 31st March 2022. I would take the opportunity at this point to thank the members of the government negotiating team, the support staff who have worked extremely hard in getting to this point. And I believe what the document reflects is a fair representation of the interests of both parties and a settlement that I believe that the employer and the employees can be comfortable with and to sustain the relationship as we go forward.
Friday's signing was done in the presence of the acting Labour Commissioner, Cornelia Jabatiste. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
The St. Lucia Bureau of Standards, together with Caribbean Export, hosted a stakeholder meeting on direct assistance grant programs or funding for small and medium enterprises. The meeting was held at the Bureau of Standards office and Don Nicholas was there.
Cuban Ambassador to St. Lucia, His Excellency Alejandro Simancas Marin, and St. Lucia's Minister for Health and Wellness, Senator the Honorable Mary Isaac, recently signed a cooperation agreement with the aim of further developing St. Lucia's health system. The renewal of the agreement is expected to extend the presence of the Cuban Medical Brigade in St. Lucia. His Excellency Alejandro Simancas Marin expressed his government's commitment to continue deepening relations with St. Lucia and to provide support in the field of health.
We are very happy. We are proud to continue contributing from our humble capabilities to the development of St. Lucia. And as I said at the beginning, in such an important area as public health. So again, I want to reaffirm that this is an important moment, and it reflects the will of our government to continue strengthening the principle of our bilateral relationship, friendship, cooperation, and solidarity.
Minister for Health and Wellness, Senator the Honorable Mary Isaac, thanked the government of the Republic of Cuba for the continued support to St. Lucia's health sector.
We have accomplished great strides through the help of the Cuban Medical Brigade that exists here, especially our eye care program that has gone a long way. We have a well-established eye care program, and that is through the Cuban assistance that we get from the Cuban government. We see you as a sister country, or maybe I should say a brother country. And as such, we do appreciate this collaboration that exists. And it does go a long way, like I said, in assisting us in our healthcare programs in St. Lucia.
Permanent Secretary in the Department of Health and Wellness, Felix St. Hill, also expressed gratitude to the government and people of the Republic of Cuba for the assistance and support in the field of health over the years. Reporting from the Communications Unit of the Ministry of Health and Wellness, I am Fennel Neptune.
Stay tuned when the DBS News World continues. The government invests in digital diagnostic equipment at St. Jude Hospital.
Over the years, Common Entrance exams results have indicated improved performances in English language and general paper, while mathematics has continued to decline. It is for that reason the Department of Education undertook the review.
Mathematics performance is not what we have expected. And as a result, we have decided to really delve into what are some of those issues that affect mathematics performance. And as we go through, we recognize that the curriculum has been incomplete in a sense. We actually have a curriculum from grade K to grade 2. However, there is no formal curriculum from grade 3 up to grade 6. So today we have decided to come together because of the fact that, one, we have developed learning standards for the OECS. And out of those learning standards, the math curriculum should come out. It should evolve from the learning standards.
Participating in the exercise were Department of Education officials, former principals, math teachers, CAMDU officials, and representatives of the National Principals Association. No timeline has been given for the completion of the review.
What we're actually looking for is a draft curriculum, after which they would need to pilot that curriculum. And based on the pilot and the evaluation, then we would need to come back and to actually complete it.
The consultation took place on Thursday, May 16, 2019, at the National Skills Development Conference Room at Bize. For the DBS News World, I am Sheffield Gillard.
Welcome back. Members of the Royal St. Lucia Police Force are breathing a sigh of relief, having concluded deliberations with the government negotiating team, or GNT, on Friday. The collective bargaining agreement covers triennium's April 2016 to March 2019, April 2019 to March 2022. According to Police Welfare Association President Travis Chico, the signing is a major victory for the police officers who over the years have been asking for salary increases and better fringe benefits. Sheffield Gillard has more.
The St. Lucia Bureau of Standards and Caribbean Export Stakeholder Meeting comes at an opportune time when many small and medium enterprises are complaining about the inaccessibility of funds for their businesses. The meeting brought together partner agencies and small businesses interested in taking advantage of this facility. The facility forms part of the Commonwealth Standard Network Project, which emphasizes the importance of businesses meeting international standards.
As part of our ongoing activities on the Commonwealth Standards Network Project, to be able to assist small and medium enterprises in St. Lucia in order to facilitate trade and to ensure that they have reasonable access to the programs and initiatives that are available to them.
The St. Lucia Bureau of Standards also celebrated May 20th as World Metrology Day. Metrology is the study of measurement.
Today we have an exhibition, a 1 kilogram unit, which was donated to the St. Lucia Bureau of Standards from NIST. And that unit is under a controlled condition where we are monitoring its temperature, the relative humidity, and the pressure, so that it has limited exposure. You cannot touch the unit.
The May 20th date is the anniversary of the signing of the Meter Convention in 1875. For the DBS News World, I am Don Nicholas.
St. Lucia and the Republic of Cuba have renewed their cooperation agreement in the health sector for another 2 years. The two countries have a long history of medical cooperation, starting in 2001. In 2005, the popular eye program, Operacion Milagro, began, and by June 2006, the first group of Cuban medical collaborators arrived in St. Lucia under the Integrated Health Program. We'll learn more from Fernel Neptune. A personal finance management workshop over the weekend gave participants a unique opportunity to discuss their money issues with a financial planner while refining their money management skills. The one-day workshop attracted young working professionals, aspiring entrepreneurs, and others interested in financial planning and improving their overall financial literacy. Alex Bousquet reports.
Organizer of the seminar, Gail Cumberbatch, saw the need to partner with Dr. Terence Martin out of the U.S. to stage Saturday's workshop. The activity covered a wide range of topics, including budgeting, estate planning, retirement planning, and investment.
It takes financial knowledge to know that you're making financial mistakes. And what we see throughout the region is a lack of basic personal finance knowledge. There have been studies done in bigger islands where you see very low financial literacy rates. And you need, everything costs us money, right? And your better understanding of personal finances will help you to better navigate within the economy, especially if you want to be an entrepreneur going to small business, or even when just going and taking out a loan. You want to make sure that you're getting the best potential option out there, intentional when you're trying to purchase things like life insurance, investments, how can we create wealth for retirement. So all these different topics are things that a lot of our parents weren't taught and our grandparents weren't taught, and we need to now have this discussion, and especially those of us that take these massive student loans to go off to university, and you come back and then you have to pay this and manage your household, manage your budget, and try to live while being indebted, one, saving for retirement, two, helping your parents. So there's a lot of moving parts to all of this.
Dr. Martin says a similar workshop was conducted in Antigua and Barbuda, and there are plans to make this an annual event staged in multiple islands. Among planned topics are customer service, social media marketing, and finance for small businesses.
We find it very hard to invest in ourselves, but we find it easy to spend money on an event, on a party, on a carnival event or whatever. So we need to change that mindset and start looking at these things as costs, look at them as events. But I kind of understand, because whenever you're talking about money, in most cases, a lot of it have been scams. So what we hope to get out of this is that people see it's not a scam. The participants then go and tell their friends. So when we do this again, one, we could offer it at a cheaper price. We could get more corporate sponsorship that would offer it at a cheaper price, get more people at the college level to come in so they could start early, right? And just share the information of what's there, because the thing that plagues our Caribbean society is information asymmetry. Those that know do well, they benefit. Those that don't know, we just continue the perpetual cycle.
The workshop was held at the Financial Administrative Center at Point Serafin in Castries. For the DBS News World, I am Alex Bousquet.
Stay tuned to DBS News World. We'll continue after these messages.
Well, good evening. Welcome to the DBS Sports. I am Kenson Casbury. The 2019 Grosley Domestic Cricket Tournament, sponsored by the district rep, Honorable Leonard Spiderman Toot, continued on Sunday, 19th May, with two development matches, followed by a match between the Minister Celebrity Team and a Grosley Veterans Team at the Grosley Playing Field. This matchup functioned as a fundraiser, and World Cup winning captain Darren Sammy was there in support.
I think today's objective was to bring out the people in Grosley, bring out the community, you know, and like I said earlier, is to showcase the guys who've played for Grosley and some of the celebrities here. And Johnson did put on a show. I saw Kenson bowl a very, very sharp first ball, and look, it shows that the crowd that turned out, you know, there's still interest in the cricket. Today was all about fun, and hopefully it really announced the league on a positive note.
Well, in this 20 overs aside encounter, Grosley veterans, upon winning the toss, made an imposing 227 for four in their allotted overs, with former under-19 batsman Jose Fede top scoring with 53. Big hitter Norbert Charles amid 33. Alan Ashby, 28 not out. Jad Goodman, 19. Arton Crafton, 18. And Ricky McDoom, 11. Arton Crafton is a representative from the Grosley Cricket League.
Well, for me, it was a lovely, lovely game, although we were on the losing end of it. But at the end of the day, cricket was the winner, so it was real fun. I saw no injuries, no pulled hamstring muscles, so because of that, lovely. Johnson Charles, you know, is still in the prime of his cricket, so he really, hit the ball around the place. But, you know, I mean, it was really enjoyable to see other players, lesser players, enjoy themselves.
Well, in response, attacking half-centuries from Johnson Charles, 81, retired. John Eugene, 63, retired, guided the celebrity team to a comfortable 6-wicket victory as they finished on 234 for 4 in 19 overs. Other useful contributions came from Kenson Casimir with 20, retired, and Kiana Joseph, 17, retired. The winning runs were scored by Darren Sammy, batting left-handed. Honorable Leonard Montuete, coming in at number 4 in the batting lineup, was dismissed for 2 runs as he attempted to clear the leg side field. We spoke to the sponsor of the day's event.
Well, it was quite an enjoyable evening. I mean, I really had a good time myself, and you know, I think it was quite entertaining to the spectators, and I think this is something we will have to perhaps do a little more often. It was all fun, and as you notice, I mean, even the high-powered guys, they made their contribution, but they declared and allowed other people to have an opportunity. So it was just all fun.
Well, earlier in the day's events, a development game between Canel Cox team and Zeta James team was played. Batting first, James team scored 138 for 7 in their allotted overs, with Disha Sherry making an undefeated 16 runs. Sam Myers took 2 wickets. In reply, Canel Cox team was dismissed for 100 runs in 18.1 overs, with Tariq Quare making 39. Cleanus Jules, he picked up 3 wickets, with 2 wickets each for Jeremiah Fede and Theo Edward. The second game played in the 14 to 15 age group of a 35 overs duration. The teams were captained by national under 15 captain Tariq Edward and West Indies female cricketer Kiana Joseph. Batting first, Edward's team, they made 169 in 35 overs, with Neandy Turville making 36. Lee John picked up 5 wickets and Zeta James picked up 2 wickets. In reply, Kiana Joseph's team was dismissed for 149 in 22 overs, with Darry Green making 26. Royce Paul bagged 7 wickets. Ryan Goodman back 3 wickets. Now, 5 St. Lucians are among the final list of players who have made themselves available for the 2019 Hero Caribbean Premier League draft, which will take place in London on Wednesday, May 22nd, 2019. The 5 are Darren Sammy, Johnson Charles, Keddy Les-Porris, Larry Edward, and John L. Eugene. Wow. This year, a record number of 536 players from 20 countries have made themselves available to play in the tournament. In football, Veterans in Sport Inc. held a very impressive tournament on the weekend, featuring teams from around the globe. In one of the matches, VSADC, they put on an impressive showing against their regional rival. Greg Bathwer is one of the players representing VSADC veterans.
This game was a typical veteran game. I mean, both teams tried to fill out each other. I mean, there was no rush, there was no urgency. We were just trying to see how they were playing. So we just kind of sat back in the first 50 minutes of the game. Luckily, we were able to score a free kick on the stroke of halftime. And I think that kind of gave us the edge. So when we came into the second half, knowing that they had to score, we played high pressure on them. and we really pinned them back in the own half. And after a long spell of pressure, we were able to get through with a second goal. And basically one that happened, given that it's only a 50-minute half, all we had to do was basically keep the ball, which we did pretty well, and we were able to secure what I think is a very comfortable win.
VSADC veterans won that match 2-0 en route to the final of the night's event. Mr. Mathres spoke to the significance of this tournament for individuals who are coming of age.
I mean, whenever you can get persons to be active, especially persons over 40, I think it's always good. It's always good to renew old rivalries, although we may not be as young and as athletic as we once were. But I think the spirit is there and we are very willing. So hopefully we will all come out unscathed with no pulled muscles and no major injuries.
The event was held at the Grosley playing field. St. Lucia will play host to an International Boxing Association IBA-funded International Technical Officials course to take place at Bay Gardens on the 22nd and 23rd of May 2019. This course will be conducted by Canadian Angel Villarreal. To date, 19 participants representing 10 countries have been registered for the course, including 5 St. Lucians. This is the first time such a course is being held in the Eastern Caribbean, and the St. Lucia Boxing Association is privileged to be chosen out of 8 countries that applied to host it. Well, participants will arrive on the island on the 21st of May 2019 and will be heralded by a cocktail reception that same evening, to which the members of the press has been invited. Nice. At this function, participants will be addressed by the president of the St. Lucia Olympic Committee, Inc., Mrs. Fortuna Belrose, director of sports, Mr. Patrick Mathre, and former Boxing Association president, Joseph Brett Pereira. We take a break, but when we get back, another college showcase in collaboration with the SLFA held in St. Lucia, and Darren Sammy thinks that the regional team actually has a shot at winning the World Cup. Is he mad? We'll tell you all when we get back. Welcome back. Former West Indies skipper Darren Sammy believes the regional team will be crowned ICC World Cup champions. The 12th edition of the tournament will mark 40 years since the West Indies won the tournament in 1979. Sammy opined that despite the fact that the team is one of the lowest ranked heading into the tournament, the number 40 could hold a charm for the team based on its religious and symbolic significance. The tournament will also be the last for arguably the region's biggest star, Christopher Henry Gale. He's expected to retire following the tournament, and the motivation could be high to give him a proper send-off. According to Sammy, West Indies will win the World Cup. With Chris Gayle retiring, the universe boss will want to leave with a bang, and hence one of the reasons Sammy's strong belief. Meanwhile, TNT cricketers Dwayne Bravo, Kieran Pollard and Carey Pierre are among the key list of reserve players chosen by Cricket West Indies for the team's World Cup squad. Interim chairman of selectors Robert Haynes said that the choice of players in the reserve list is really to cover the bases and ensure that the team has a good balance in the pool of players that can be selected if replacements are required. Meanwhile, the West Indies will continue preparation for the ICC Cricket World Cup with a training camp in Southampton, England from the 19th to 23rd of May 2019. West Indies have warm-up engagements against South Africa on May 26 and New Zealand on May 28. Now, the St. Lucia Football Association Inc. staged what can be hailed as a very successful college of football showcase at the Saab playing field on a Saturday 18th and Sunday 19th May 2019. Over 125 young footballers descended on the Saab playing field for the exciting showcase. Video representation of these players are expected to be uploaded on websites so as to allow scouts from schools and football clubs to consider the talent from St. Lucia. Nice touch. Manchester City completed a historic treble as they disposed of Watford on the weekend. Take a look.
This break, De La Feo, here's the chance, super save by Edison. That is absolutely top class from Manchester City's goalkeeper. As Roberto Pereira looks set to give Watford the lead.
Well, Zinchenko's got his head in his hands, he knew it was his pass that created the opportunity for Watford, they worked it beautifully.
Controlled by Mahrez, who's had a super start. Bernardo Silva, and Mahrez stepovers are happening once more. Up will go Sterling, and Gomez made a bit of a mess of that. Sterling again, David Silva with the chance! Lifting it in for Jesus! Whose goal is it? It's a second for City, Mahrez, he's passed Olivas again.
Beautiful.
And there's a shimmy past the next man, and a save by Gomez to stop Gabriel Jesus. Now, it's a cross to De Bruyne. Magnificent! De Bruyne for Manchester City. Right. And running through. Jesus scores a fourth for Manchester City. Chance for Capu. Norva. Silva across. Scored.
Here comes Raheem Sterling to stick it in the back.
Bernardo Silva's made the run. Bernardo Silva. De Bruyne. Gomez saves, but Sterling reacts again. Raheem Sterling doubles up on his day.
Well, City won this encounter 6-0. Finally, the Raptors registered an overtime victory over the Bucks to keep the NBA East Coast Finals interesting.
Lopez played on a switch by Lowry. They double up. Lowry off the steal. Leonard on the drive.
And that's how Toronto has to play. Create some offense from your defense.
Middleton on a catch and shoot from downtown. Here's Leonard ahead of the field. Here is Leonard with the runner. Yes, and it counts. Giannis on the drive and scores. Dedekumbo once again.
That was a double Euro step. Not gonna lie, that was a double Euro step. You know Giannis can step with the best of them, but Jeremy Lin's over there like, what the heck just happened?
Here's Powell. Gasol able to keep it alive. They reset to 14. And Lowry knocks down a three. Lowry for three. Yes. Shot clock to three. Lowry. Yes.
And we know they've come back from double digits in these playoffs.
Off the collision, an open shot for Leonard for three.
That's a big shot right there. What a big time player.
Giannis will tee it up for three. Here's the lead out. Leonard. And Leonard with the follow. Gasol changed his mind. Siakam for three. With the runner. Kawhi off the dribble, fires. And it's picked off by Hill. Blocked into the open floor. And a foul as Hill is hit and will head to the line in overtime. And Hill has tied it. We're down to 5 seconds in overtime. Leonard. Leonard with a fadeaway comes up short. And we're headed to a second overtime. Bledsoe wants to set it. Here comes Leonard near a pitch back. Leonard all the way and puts it down. Middleton working off the screen from Lopez. Middleton gets underneath. Middleton not able to hit, but it's tipped home. Leonard with the steal. Lopez to the ball. Oh, it's rejected by Siakam. Siakam from the blind side. Leonard with a beautiful move and scores. Kawhi Leonard has given Toronto a 4-point lead. 34 points for Leonard.
Raptors won 118-112. Game 4 will be held on Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. Well, tonight we will see the West Coast. As sports, of course, don't forget to join me for 758 Sports Talk. My guest, Hassan Ariste, and of course, Joseph Reds Pereira. We're talking cricket. See you guys then.
Time now for commentary. Here's your presenter.
If you are one of the church faithful and you accept the word of the preachers and the prophets as gospel, you have probably heard it said, and maybe some of you believe it, that all the blame for the trials and tribulations of the world rests squarely at the feet of women. According to the teachings, it was a woman who committed the original sin. It was a woman who broke the first cardinal rule. All of society's troubles, every one of them, is woman's fault. For Adam was first form, then Eve. And Adam was not deceived, but the woman, being deceived, was in the transgression. It was Eve who was beguiled by the serpent in the Garden of Eden. It was Eve who saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise. It was Eve who took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave it to her husband also, and he did eat. Because of what Eve did, the wrath of God has befallen us all. God's punishment upon Eve: I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. The words of the good book are used by the preachers and the prophets, and by the many, many men out there who want to rule over us to get us to accept what they have decided is our fate. According to those who would have us back in the fields and the kitchens and the bedrooms, the world is in confusion because women have not remained in their designated roles as mere helpmate to man. Men don't know where they stand anymore. They no longer recognize what their role is in the family or in the society. It was even suggested just recently that young single women in particular, those who are not yet wives, yet have conceived, that they are the persons largely responsible for creating today's criminals. Again, blame and shame on the women. No responsibility on the men. Seriously, people? Obviously, this is not the time or medium to explain how children are created. Those who condemn women for bringing forth new life know well how it works. It takes two to tango. But our laws have historically ignored the responsibility of the man to those born out of wedlock. Our civil code refers to those born within a marriage as lawful issue of the spouses, and the code recognizes their rights. Those born outside of the marriage are considered unlawful, born outside of the law, illegitimate they are called, filius nullius, child of no one, commonly known as bastard or bata. Recommendations were made to our legislators many years ago to make our family law somewhat more equitable for all children. Along with these recommendations, there were also provisions for the recognition of the status of the mothers of these illegitimate children. The recommendations propose that a domestic partnership be established between a man and a woman by operation of law on the day after a continuous period of cohabitation for 5 years, whether or not one or both of the partners is in a domestic partnership with another person. This following the 1981 Barbados Family Law Act, which is the first in the region to give legal recognition to unions other than marriage. The Barbados Act makes it clear at Section 22 that the court will have regard to the need to give the widest possible protection and assistance to the family as the natural and fundamental group unit of society, particularly while it is responsible for the care and education of dependent children. In this jurisdiction, there is no protection for domestic partnerships. There is no such thing as a common law marriage where the parties thereto are protected or supported by law. The concept of common law wife and common law husband does not exist in St. Lucia. our family law reform bill, which I recall was discussed at length as far back as 2004, now sits on some dusty shelf in some government office because some persons found the provisions inconvenient. In St. Lucia, a large number of our citizens are born outside of marriage. That is our reality. But if state and church alike choose to ignore that reality and not reach out to assist those who are considered born unlawful or in sin, we will forever be searching for solutions to rein in our young delinquents, those whom we have been content so far to let exist on the fringes of society. We need simply to stop spinning top in mud, stop the useless talk, and get on with what needs to be done to settle our particular social issues. For commentary, I am Lorraine Deborah Glass.
On the lighter side tonight, the Children's Garden Learning Center in Soufre is having a double celebration this month. The center is celebrating Child Month and Reading Month. Students have been participating in a host of activities, including a pajama day and most recently, career day. The students got to show up in the costumes depicting the careers they hoped to hold one day. Students portrayed a variety of professionals, or professions rather, including nurses and police officers. But one in particular caught our eye. That's a student with aspirations of maybe one day being a DBS News reporter. He showed up with his DBS cap, press pass, and even had something none of us have but wish we did. A bag that also doubles as a video camera. Other activities to mark the month include a character day this Friday and a boat tour of Soufre's waterfront the following week. And that's your lighter side and our news. Before we go, let's take one more look at our top stories. St. Lucians told to stay hydrated amid concerns that high temperatures could lead to heat-related illnesses. Guy Joseph continues to downplay calls for his resignation or dismissal over what the opposition says is his gross misbehavior. The Ministry of Agriculture blames climate change and bad agricultural practices for declining bee populations, and St. Lucia and Cuba extend cooperation in the health sector. That's the DBS News World for today. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Kendall Burton, wishing you a restful and enjoyable evening.